Hi, my name is Richard Clark. I'm from Provar. And in this session, I want to take you through our new Provar test integration application, how you can install it, and how you can integrate it with your existing Provar tests. We've released a guide on the Provar test integration pack, which will go through everything that we're going to talk about in the next few minutes. Useful within that is there's a link, a bit.ly link, Provar TIR, which will take you onto a private app exchange package where you can install the package to your target organization. Before you do that, do think about where you want to install the package. If you install it to a sandbox, remember when that sandbox is refreshed, you'll lose all of your data. So you may want to use a separate developer edition, trial org, or even your own production org if that's where you want to store your results. When you install the package, you will also have an option for whether to install it for admins only, all users, or specific profiles. If you're in doubt, please install it for admins only. There is a permission set within the package which you can use to apply to a different user after installation. The people that need access are the users by which you're going to write the results. They don't necessarily have to have admin access to do that. Once you've installed the package, I'm then going to show you how to configure your Provar tests. So I'll give you a few minutes to install that. Pause the video if you haven't already installed the package, and then come back to me when you're ready to continue. Hi, welcome back. Hopefully now you've installed the package, you'll see there's a new application Provar test execution available in Classic, and a similar one for Lightning, which you can access. You won't have any data yet, so let's fix that. I'm going to switch into my Provar desktop. Now, the first thing we need to do is create some setup and tear down test cases and a callable test that we use within all of our existing cases. The good news is there's very minimal impact on your existing test cases that you want to log. First thing we need to do is create a test setup. So if you do new test case, make sure you pick the setup test case option, give it a name. Okay, and you don't need to launch Test Builder. Make sure you pick the right org you want to connect to. So within this environment, what I've also done, I've added a second connection object, this one for my results org. So I've got the thing I want to test, my demo sandbox, and I've got my results org in here as well. So this, all the things we're going to create here are going against the results org where you want to store your results. And click Finish when you're done with that. I've already created my setup test case. Here we are. And within your setup test case, you've got your connection, and we want to add a set values from the test APIs. And we're going to call that test run start. So what I'm doing here is I've chosen to log the exact start time when my test suite is executed. Important to remember the value scope. So normally that defaults to test case. I've changed that to test run. So without the throughout the test suite execution, I can always get access to this variable in order to calculate the total time the test suite took to execute. And the important step is I've grabbed and dropped one of the Provar test suite execution objects into my test builder. And under that, I've configured just one parameter, one field, which is the name of the test, which I've chosen to call it an execution and give it a date time. You're free to use any naming convention you want to record your test fields. You're free to add additional fields to the objects that we've contained in the packages if you want to store other information, such as the browser, the test cycle, test environment. You can do that within your object here. Okay, the next thing I've done is create a teardown test case. So in just the same way, new test, I chose teardown test case. Now I've chosen to do this, it's totally optional. So what I've chosen to do here is if there is an active test suite execution, because remember we set that test scope to be the entire test run, then I'm going to connect and do an update to that record. And I'm using the current time less that start run time that we saw earlier. And the reason the calculation 1440 is in there is I don't want to know the time in seconds, I want to know the time in minutes. So I've calculated that instead. And finally, I've got a callable test here. So it's a little bit more complex. So within my test I've made callable, I've added three parameters. I'm passing in the name of the test case that's being tested, the result of that test case, and its own start time, which we're going to talk about in a second. I've then within this done a set values on test result, pulling in that test case result parameter, and then I'm changing that based on the result that's been passed in. So normal Provar tests, the test come outcome is either a successful or failed. We didn't find that very useful for reporting. It looked a bit odd when you have a report talking about successfuls and faileds. So we're using the terms pass and fail within our reports here. So I'm just setting that result to pass and fail. At the moment, you can't record a skipped test. We're looking at ways in which we can add that functionality in the future, but I've put that in here for that eventuality when that's possible. Finally, I've got another object insert. This time I'm inserting to the test case execution instead of test suite execution object. And in this record, I'm using the test suite execution ID that we recorded of an hour initialize. I'm getting the current time for the end of my test. I'm getting the status, the pass or the fail or the skipped. I'm getting the name of the test case that was passed as an input parameter to this callable test. And the start time that's also passed in as a callable parameter. I've chosen to put some literal comments in here, but you're free to store anything else. And again, you can extend this object with any other information you want to record at the test case level that's relevant to you for reporting purposes. Let's now see how we've used that. So I'm just going to close these down. Here's my existing test. So it's going to connect into my demo sandbox, the environment where I'm testing. It's creating a company name and creating an account and a contact. For that account and contact, it's then creating a case using the UI. And in that UI, it's using my new account and contact. It's using the new set by index on some pick lists I wanted to test. And I'm just going to assert at the end that the case priority is medium, which is a rule that I've got. That's my default when it's not been set. So I just want to assert that in this test. So a very simple example, but a bit more relevant than a 2 + 2 = 4. Let me go into the test APIs. The first thing I want to do is capture the start time for my test. Now it's up to you where you put this step. Personally, I believe you should put it at the start, very start of the test case as early as possible. But if you want to exclude the Salesforce connection from your test, so you're measuring the actual performance of your application rather than the performance of the Salesforce platform, by all means, put it after the connect step. Just make sure you're consistent in where you place it. So I'm going to call this start time, and I'm just going to put in the now function so that I can capture the start. And I've got one other change to make. I'm going to take the finally block. I'm going to drop that at the end of my test. Now remember, the finally block will always execute whether your test passes or fails. I'm just going to put description in. Is that, despite what it says in the description, it is actually optional. Log the test results to Salesforce. Okay. And then I'm going to grab that callable test I just created. And I'm going to pull that in and drop it on top of that finally block. All I then have to do is set the parameters of that callable test we just created. And if I use the control space in the expression editor, what I can do is pull the test case name out. And for the test case result, I'm taking the test case outcome. And finally, for the start time, I'm going to take that again from the expression editor. That's the value I created up here. And I save that. And now if I just run my test, we'll see it execute. We'll see it fire up the UI once it's done the API steps. We see that the test case initialize has fired. So it's created our test suite execution record with this ID. See, it's now firing up the browser using the Selenium Chrome driver, populating some values using our unique IDs. And there we go, that's saved. I'll return to Provar desktop. We'll see that cert step fire, and our finally block is now executing. test result successful, so we've set result of pass, and that's complete. So let's see the results of that in our org. If I go to the test suite execution record I created, if I just click on that, it's going to fire me up a new browser session, and here's our results. I've got a total of one test. The whole test took 40 seconds, but it was a pass. That's all very interesting, fairly limited example. So what we've included is some dashboards for you to use to make it even easier to look at the results. So we've put some example dashboards in with a pass rate, some pass fail trends. Obviously, I've only been working on this 1 week, so I haven't got a very good line chart there. Some test history, recent test results, so on and so forth. So one of the more interesting ones I find is the most brittle test cases. So because I've logged the test case names, I'm able to see which of my test cases are failing most often. Obviously, my test case failure is failing every single time. If I just refresh this dashboard, we'll see that it changes the results that I've just created. There we go. It's a small increase, but it's an increase nonetheless. A new test is now showing within this dashboard. You can also look at your dashboard in Lightning, which we definitely recommend. So here's an example in Lightning. Again, I'll refresh this to get the latest information. Unfortunately, still stuck at that 63% mark when it's rounded up. But you see here within Lightning, I'm able to make much better use of the real estate and make my longer lists more meaningful and use the wider space where I need to for my line charts, for example. It's basically the same dashboard as one we saw in Classic. Use the examples that I've shown you in this demo today. Within our documentation, you will find a link to GitHub where you can download the test setup, teardown, and the callable test. You just need to change the connection to the Salesforce org where you want to store your results. Hope that's been very useful to you, and happy reporting.